Tantor Audio presents Separated at Birth, a true love story of twin sisters reunited. By Anaïs Bordier and Samantha Futerman, with Lisa Pulitzer. Narrated by Emily Wu Zeller. 1. Anaïs.
The first time I caught a glimpse of her. Saturday, December 15th, 2012, was the most incredible day of my life. On this day, while sitting on a double-decker bus near Oxford Circus, shivering from the winter rain and rushing to the warmth of my shared flat in Finsbury Park, I discovered there was a young woman in America who looked exactly like me. Her image, a screenshot from a YouTube video, had been sent to my cell phone by a friend. The young Asian woman so closely resembled me that she had to be my double. The day had started out like any other. An early morning wake-up followed by 2 cups of strong French coffee and a few bites of a croissant. I wanted to stay in bed and out of the rain, but I had an important mission. To find fabrics for my designs that I would be presenting in the Central St. Martin's Graduate Fashion Show in the spring. All final year students at the University of the Arts London's Central St. Martin's College of Art and Design would be presenting 6 pieces in May. And in 90 seconds, each of our collections, which had taken an entire final year's worth of energy, would be up and down the catwalk. But when this requisite was behind me, I would receive a degree in fashion design from one of the top fashion schools in the world. Alexander McQueen, John Galliano, and Stella McCartney were among its distinguished alumni. I was well on my way to having the drawings design portion of my portfolio ready, so I could now start collecting my fabrics. Christmas break was looming, however, and I had a lot to do. After breakfast, I went to Soho and looked over the excellent inventories at my 3 favorite fabric stores, secured a few swatches that I really liked, and was settling myself on the bus back to my flat when my cell phone buzzed. It was a notification from Facebook, alerting me that a friend, Kelsang, had posted something on my wall. I opened my Facebook wall immediately, only to have my breath taken away. There, in front of my eyes, was a screenshot of a presumed stranger, but whoever she was, she had the same eyes, the same skin, the same hair length and color, the same nose, and the same smile as me. My internet connection on the bus was really bad, so I couldn't do any more investigating until I got home, still 20 minutes away. I was in complete disbelief. I was adopted from South Korea as an infant and raised in France, so all my life, I had wondered if there were people out there who looked like me. The girl grinning back at me on my Samsung Galaxy looked so much like me that I thought one of my autistic friends might be pranking me. They were all very creative and could manipulate images with ease, and they all loved a good laugh, so it was reasonable to think this could be a joke. Every possibility of who this girl might be consumed me for the remainder of the ride. Was she a doppelganger? Was she a relative? Was she real? Was she an imposter? Did she know about me? When I finally got home, I ran straight to my computer. It turned out Kelsang had been surfing through YouTube videos when he had stumbled upon my lookalike. She was an actress in a short video called High School Virgin, a stage comic piece where she was playing the role of a teenage tease. The entire video was only 4 minutes long. My double had a 40-second speaking part, but as none of the 4 actors was credited, I didn't have her name. The more I watched the video, the more I thought I was looking at myself, except for the American-accented English. When I speak English, I do so with a British accent. But other than the accent, I could not find a single difference that would distinguish one of us from the other. All I could find were the similarities. Who was she? I knew I needed to find her. I got in touch with Kelsang as fast as I could and asked him how he had come across the video. He told me he had been doing some research, and it had popped up on the right side of his computer screen. The female character had looked so much like me that he had posted her picture to my Facebook wall for me to see. I didn't ask him what he was researching that would bring up a title called High School Virgin, because that was his business, but I was thankful that he had. I love everything about Kelsang. He and I have been friends since my 2nd year at Central St. Martin's. He is Tibetan, came to school with more experience in fashion than I did, and is always teaching me personal fashion tricks. Part of my intrigue with the mysterious American stemmed from the fact that I was adopted. I don't have any siblings, and I don't resemble anyone in my family, including my European parents, Patricia and Jacques Bordier. My mother is blonde-haired and blue-eyed, and my father is as French-looking as they get. Even though there is a neighborhood in Paris with a very small Korean population, it was nowhere near Neuilly-sur-Seine, where I lived. I knew other Asians, but I didn't look very much like them either, although people joked that we all looked alike. A lot of French people tend to think of all Asians as Chinese. I had one Korean friend, but she was 8 years older. She had been adopted too, and coincidentally she was also named Anaïs. We went to the same Catholic school in Neuilly, Institut Saint-Dominique. When we had glasses on, we looked quite similar. Anaïs was like a big sister to me when I was growing up, protective and kind. We had become friends when I was 5, and my mother had come to pick me up in the schoolyard at dismissal. She called my name, so the other Anaïs turned around too. Our mothers started talking, and it turned out the other Anaïs had also been adopted from South Korea. It was nice to have that in common with someone. Throughout my life, I had always hoped to find someone who looked like me. I'm not sure, but it might be a common theme among adopted children to speculate on who could be in your family. Being an only child, too, I probably fantasized about these things even more. When I was very young, I had an imaginary friend I called Anne. My mom didn't know about her until the mother of one of my school friends told her. "I didn't know Anaïs had a sister," the mother said. My mom assured her that I didn't. A lot of only children had imaginary friends, but I was longing for a sibling, not just a best friend. I didn't just want a permanent playdate. I wanted someone I could relate to in physical appearance. But I had never found anyone. Until now. I watched High School Virgin at least 10 more times, convinced the Asian actress was somehow related to me, maybe a half-sister or a cousin. When I showed Marie, my roommate, the video, she was as blown away as I had been. We both agreed that the girl looked slightly younger than me, but identical in every other way. Marie was great at computer sleuthing, and tried various searches that might lead to an identification. But, like me, she came up empty. Over the next few days, I sat at the kitchen table with my laptop open. I wanted to contact Kevin Wu, aka Kev Jumba, the Chinese-American humorist and director of the video, but I worried that a message would get lost amid the fan messages on his Facebook page, or in the comments on his YouTube videos. High School Virgin had more than 2 million views and 15,000 comments, so how would he see mine? Wednesday evening, I had happened to have dinner with my friend Oliver, who claimed to be a physiognomist, someone who supposedly can assess a person's character by his or her facial features. I was anxious to get his reaction to the mystery girl. "She has to be your sister," he exclaimed after seeing her picture. "You look exactly the same." He was insistent that I find a way to get in touch with Kev Jumba, but this kind of encouragement made me more scared than excited. Who knew what I would find out? I wasn't ready for rejection, and I had to entertain that rejection was a possibility. This girl might not have any interest in me whatsoever. On Thursday, I was taking the Eurostar to Paris for Christmas break. Before I headed out that morning, Marie had me pose the same way the American was postured in her screenshot, and she snapped a couple of photos of me. She wanted to create a split-screen photo montage of the two of us for comparison purposes. Even before my train pulled into Paris, her creation had been posted on my Facebook wall. Looking at us side by side, I could only be in total awe of our resemblance. My father picked me up at Gare du Nord. Although he knew I was perfectly capable of taking the metro the 4 miles home, he didn't want to wait that long to see me. When we got to our flat, I was so anxious to show my parents Marie's photo montage. I didn't even stop to say hello to Eiko, our American Cocker Spaniel, who was jumping at my legs as I raced to the dining room table to turn on my laptop. My mother was disappointed that I hadn't given the dog a warmer greeting, but I knew she would forgive me when she saw what was so compelling. Turning my parents' attention to the photo montage displayed on my laptop, I waited for them to react. "So, what are the differences in the pictures?" I asked. "Well, first, you are more tanned in one," Mum guessed, pointing to the American girl's photo occupying the top half of the screen. And it is not me, I jumped in. "Exactly what I was going to say. It's not you in this picture." Mum smiled. It was probably too embarrassing to admit that she wasn't able to identify her own daughter. Over dinner, I explained that my friend Kelsang had uncovered a video with a dead ringer of me in it, then showed them the 40 seconds of High School Virgin that featured her. They were both amused by the video, despite the abundance of American cussing. But they also came up with a lot of reasons why this girl could not be my sister. My father told me about a Korean actress he was familiar with, who looked just like me. He had been watching Korean movies in his free time, and had come across this particular woman in several films.
"You can always find people who look similar," he reasoned.
My father is an amazing person and incredibly smart, but in this case, I had to disagree with him. "This girl and I don't look similar. We look exactly the same," I insisted. I didn't want to be talked out of my fantasy, and I wanted my parents to indulge me, not try to dissuade me, even if they were trying to protect me. My mother explained that she had addressed the option of adopting twins when she first signed on with Holt International Children's Services, the adoption agency that handled my case. She had told them that if twins became available, she would happily adopt both of them. That was even a question on her application. "Would you take twins?" She told me that there would have been no reason to separate me from a twin sister if I had been part of a pair. They had a copy of my birth record, too. It said, "Single birth," and my parents had full faith that it was correct. My mother's point was strong. The more I thought about it, the more I talked myself into believing that this girl was not my twin, or even a relative. Any further mention of her was simply for fun, and done in a joking manner. I had a doppelganger somewhere in America, and that was that. Even so, I continued to surreptitiously check Kevjumba's Facebook page, Twitter feed, and website every day, still hoping I would come across the girl's name. By the end of Christmas holiday, I had stopped searching, although I still thought about her. As much as I accepted that our similarities were likely coincidences, I was still haunted that she could be someone in my birth family. What if she had already discovered me at some point and hadn't really cared to pursue it? Maybe she knew about me, and hoped I would never know about her. I also reasoned that if I had been born a twin, I would have known it in my heart via some telepathic longing. But I never had emotions like that. Until now. My curiosity was piqued enough for me to do a little research about my birthplace, Busan, a huge port in the south of Korea. With more than 3 million people, it was the second largest city in South Korea, complete with an abundance of skyscrapers, plenty of seafood, and a tourism industry built around the beaches. My parents had taken me there on a family vacation when I was 7 years old, determined to show me my roots, but I was too young to really appreciate it. Now I was fascinated to learn the city had a huge Russian mafia presence, the largest in all of Asia. I wondered if perhaps I could have some Russian blood. There was also the possibility I had American blood. Camp Hialeah, a U.S. military base in Busan until it closed in 2006, had several hundred U.S. servicemen stationed there. It was a well-known fact that U.S. servicemen often abandoned their Korean wives and children when their tours of duty were over. Maybe I was part American, and my birth father had been in the service, and then abandoned my mother? I started imagining different scenarios, but in the end, who cared if I was part Russian or American by blood? Patricia and Jacques Bordier were my parents, and the only parents I cared to know. By the time I got back to London, I had put my American twin to the back of my mind. When mid-February 2013 came around, I was back in full work mode. I had to get some toiling fabrics, and I was on the bus heading to Woolcrest and Hackney accompanied by Kelsang and Lucas,
another friend of ours. Out of nowhere, Gelsang mentioned he had seen the American girl again in the trailer of a soon-to-be-released American movie called 21 and Over. I immediately typed the name of the film into my cell phone, hoping I could find her in the cast. Sure enough, there she was. Samantha Futerman. I was beyond excited. Now that I had her name, I Googled her, and the first thing that popped up was a link to her profile on the popular internet movie database, IMDb. The picture of her on that website looked as much like me as her cameo in High School Virgin. Next to her photo was the biggest shock of all, her date of birth, which was the same as mine, November 19th, 1987. I froze. I thought I had probably read it wrong, transposing it in my mind to what I had hoped to see. But when I looked again, it was still reading, November 19th, 1987. Gelsang! I screamed across the bus. The girl from the YouTube video. She was born November 19th, 1987. So what? Gelsang asked, not understanding the importance. So, I was born on November 19th, 1987, I explained. Could she be my twin sister? Her name was very American, Samantha Futerman, so she must have been adopted too. Now that I could see her closely, I could see details I hadn't seen before. Mon Dieu, she even has the same freckles on her nose as I have. By the time I got off the bus, I was beginning to feel faint. On the walk to school, I was a wreck. I called my parents to tell them what I had learned. My mother gasped when I told her about the shared birth date. Do you think she could be her twin sister? She asked in disbelief. My dad called back later, but he was skeptical. He told me he wanted to look up Samantha Futerman himself to see what he could find. 5 minutes later, he called back saying she wasn't my twin, as he had found a website that indicated she had been born on the 1st of November, not the 19th. He admitted several sites had said November 19th, but he needed me to be aware that there were other facts that contradicted the date I chose to believe. We hung up with him locked into the idea that it wasn't possible for Samantha Futerman to be my twin. The day was so strange. I was feeling completely turned around. I think I was in shock, but I just didn't know it. When I finally settled into the studio and started working on my collection, spreading my fabric out on my work table, I still kept staring at Samantha's photo on my laptop as I obsessively reread her IMDb profile. I was so impressed to see that she had been in several films, some of them big, including Memoirs of a Geisha, an adaptation from a huge international best-selling book, which I had seen with my mother when it came to France when I was 17. Samantha played a young Japanese girl named Satsu, the older sister of the lead role. At the time, she did not jump out at me as my doppelganger. She was heavily made up to look Japanese. My studio mates were hard at work, but at the risk of being annoying, I simply had to communicate my excitement. That girl is born the same day as me, and she's adopted too! I'd blurt out whenever the urge hit me. I had no proof she was related to me, but it was making complete sense in my head, and I was compelled to share. People could draw their own conclusions, but I was already convinced. Things started getting even freakier, really fast. Lucas directed me to several more YouTube videos he had discovered that featured Samantha, pointing out that she and I had the same inflection and delivery in our voices. No video of Samantha's blew me away more than the one titled, How It Feels to Be Adopted, I Am Sam. It was a humorous 3-minute skit of Samantha being questioned about her feelings about adoption. Friends were asking her purposefully naive questions, such as, was she from North or South Korea? How come she didn't look like the rest of her family? And if she felt sad and alone because her birth parents had given her up? She reveals that she has 2 American brothers, one of whom we meet in the video. Did this mean I had 2 American brothers too? At one point, she dresses up as Little Orphan Annie and belts out the song Tomorrow. I found it incredibly amusing, but more important, it was my confirmation that we were twins. Her mannerisms, her voice, even her sense of humor, were mine. I raced home to the safety of my computer, where I started sending the How It Feels to Be Adopted, I Am Sam video to everyone I could think of. Enlisting friends, I also launched my massive campaign to figure out a way to get in touch with Samantha Futerman, putting all my faith in social media. We were unsuccessful in locating a Facebook page for her, but Kelsang did find her Instagram on his cell phone. We went through all of her pictures, with me feeling a little guilty at the depths of my snooping. But it was so much fun! We found very recent pictures of her on a trip to Korea. One of them had her posing with a woman she identified as her foster mother. She looked very happy to be with her. Next, we found Samantha Futerman on Twitter. She had been tweeting a lot lately, so I got to spy on her back-and-forth conversations. As paradoxical as it sounds, I was discovering her both slowly and quickly, all without her knowledge. Someone suggested we try working backward to find her Facebook page by finding a relative of hers on her Twitter, then seeing if we could locate that person's Facebook page. If we were successful, we could hope to find a Samantha in that list of friends. We chose a Twitterer named Joe Futterman, searched the name on Facebook, opened Joe Futterman's friends inventory, and had a match. Someone named Samantha was on Joe's list. I clicked on her name, and up came the same photo we'd seen on her Instagram. I had found her! Most of her information was private, but I would find a way to contact her, no matter what I had to do. Flying to America crossed my mind, but I would save that as a last resort. I started composing a message with what I thought was just the right tone. Not too scary, not too funny. Something that would not freak her out and put her off, but would be serious enough to attract her interest. Finally, I sent a friend request with the following message. Hey, my name is Anaïs. I am French and live in London. About 2 months ago, my friend was watching one of your videos with Kev Jumba on YouTube, and he saw you and thought we looked really similar. Like, very, really similar. We were making jokes about it, etc. I'm always being violent with people and hitting them too. Today, he saw the trailer of 21 and Over and told me he saw you again. I then checked your name on the cast, stalked you a bit, and found out you were born on the 19th of November, 1987. I checked more of your videos, which are hilarious, and then came upon the How It Feels to Be Adopted, and discovered you were adopted too. So, I don't want to be too Lindsay Lohan. Well, but, how to put it, I was wondering where you were born? I was born on the 19th of November, 1987, in Busan, but my papers were made at the Holt Children's Institute, so, officially, I was born in Seoul. My Korean name is Kim Eun-hwa. I arrived in France the 5th of March, 1988, so 3 months later. You can check my Facebook if you want to check the pictures and the videos. It's more obvious on videos. Let me know. Don't freak out. Lots of love. Anaïs. I absolutely had to get her attention. I needed her to answer me in any fashion she wanted. But I needed her to know I was looking for her.
2. Sam. The day a French girl landed on my lap. Top. When I got out of bed on February 21st, 2013, I believed that my entire day was going to revolve around the premiere of a movie I was in, a major release called 21 and Over. This was my third year living in Los Angeles, doing the acting, waitressing thing. When I wasn't in a role or auditioning for one, I worked as a waitress in an upscale brasserie in Beverly Hills. Being cast in films like 21 and Over was a good reminder that I was progressing in my career, and not just chasing an empty dream. The premiere that night was a red carpet event. Being the total spaz that I am, I don't really like walking the carpet. I find it completely nerve-wracking and not in the least bit appealing. I know it would be more fascinating if I liked the glamour of galas like this, but the truth is, I get uncomfortable. Probably because I feel like it's crazy that I'm even at these stylish parties with all the Hollywood heavy hitters. Even when I get dressed up, I feel like I should be on the catering staff,
passing hors d'oeuvres, as I do in my financial supporting role of waitress. I always find myself eyeing empty drink glasses, wondering if I should put them on a small round tray and take them to the kitchen. This was the second red carpet event of my career. My first one, the opening of Memoirs of a Geisha, had definitely been an experience. Glamorous, thrilling, and terrifying all at the same time. I don't remember many details, except that the food was incredible. I ate and drank myself to the point of delirium, and left the party the happier for it. The premiere of 21 and Over was being held at the Westwood Village Regency Theater, which added to the extravagance of it. This grand old movie house, formerly the Fox Theater, has hosted some of the biggest premieres in the history of Hollywood, including those of the Harry Potter franchise. I was a huge fan of Harry Potter, but I could never be cast in the films. When J.K. Rowling sold the rights to Warner Brothers in 1998, she stipulated that the cast be British, except parts whose nationalities were identified in the books. As she didn't have any Asian-Jewish female characters, that eliminated me. But just being in the same venue as the opening of such a monumental film series made me look forward to it. All the stars of 21 and Over, including Miles Teller, Justin Chan, and Skylar Astin, were going to be in attendance. We had loads of fun filming together. Justin and I even went bar hopping after set, tossing back beers while bonding over being Asian American actors. Like most mothers today, mine was cursed with contemporary reference dyslexia and kept getting the name of the film confused. But I know she loves me, and getting the movie's name right wasn't the most important thing in the world. She had raised me with love and support, and I honored her for that. The day of the premiere was also my father's birthday. He was turning old. Little did I know that on his special day, I would soon be getting a huge gift of my own. One my whole family would enjoy for the rest of our lives. I woke up early on the 21st. Early, generally falling between the hours of 8 and 10 a.m. I headed over to my girlfriend Lauren's apartment to have my nails painted. Lauren was a hostess at the restaurant where I waitressed, and we had become close friends with our shared crude senses of humor. Being a Jersey girl, I would be a complete disgrace if I stepped onto the red carpet without a manicure, and Lauren had offered to be my nail artist for the gala. Around 11, while we were chatting and doing my nails, a Twitter message from someone I didn't know popped up on my iPhone. "Hey, Sam. My friend Anaïs has sent you a message on FB. Check it. Smiley face. It might be in the spam box." Normally, a stranger contacting me via Twitter or Facebook would creep me out. I had all my Facebook settings set to private in order to avoid these strangers reaching me. However, this time, for some unknown reason, I pulled up my Facebook page to see what this was all about. I didn't have a message from an Anaïs, so I checked my friend requests. Right there, about 1 square inch in size, I saw a picture of myself. My first thought was, great, a creepy Kev Jumba fan saw me on his YouTube channel and made a fake Facebook page of me. Kevin had a massive YouTube following and very dedicated subscribers, so it wasn't out of the realm of possibility. And with all the catfishing out there, who's to say what the truth was? But I clicked into the picture anyway. That's when I realized it was not a picture of me. It was an actual girl. A real live girl named Anaïs who looked exactly like me. As I clicked around her profile, I learned that she was 25 and lived in London. I saw that we shared a birth date, but for some reason it didn't register as something significant. It was more like, oh yeah, same birthday. Weird. I showed Anaïs's friend request to Lauren, who was still painting my nails, but neither of us knew what I should do about it. Finally, again for some inexplicable reason, I decided that Anaïs was legit, and I accepted her friend request. Just as quickly as I had friended her, I wished I hadn't. I rarely accepted strangers into my world, and I was already regretting my haste in this decision. Excusing myself from Lauren's polishing, I went over to her computer and changed my Facebook privacy settings immediately. This way, Anaïs would have only a restricted view of my profile, which made me feel much more secure. Just because she looked like me didn't mean I had to let my guard down. A second or two after my settings were fixed, my phone alerted me to a Facebook message from this very Anaïs, who I was trying to keep at arm's length. Anaïs Bordier. Just when I thought I was at a safe distance, here she was again. I felt strangely calm as I decided to see what she had to say. It was almost as if there was some divine intervention guiding me towards someone I was destined to encounter. I had no other explanation. I didn't know what to think about the girl's message. She was awesome, and I loved her Lindsay Lohan reference to The Parent Trap. In that movie, Lindsay Lohan plays both sisters and a pair of identical twins separated as infants and raised on different continents. I knew Anaïs was implying that somehow we could be identical twin sisters too, separated at birth and raised on different continents. Her message seemed too sincere to be a joke. In the pit of my gut, I could feel how possible it was that this could be true. Now that we were Facebook friends, I had access to her photos and albums, and I got right to examining them. I had to make sure she wasn't a poser, making up a phony identity. Anaïs was also secure in her settings on Facebook, which was a sign that, like me, she took her privacy seriously. Her photos all looked legitimate. What was most impressive about them was that she looked just like me. Not like a cousin, not like a doppelganger, like a mirror image of me. I started scrolling around her albums for a while. The similarities I was discovering in the pictures were uncanny. In one of them, she was looking at a menu in some restaurant. A commenter had written facetiously, "I want this, and this, and this," seeming to indicate that Anaïs always wanted to taste everything. That was just like me. I always wanted to try every single item on the menu, and announce it in an overly excited manner. Even more bizarre, she had freckles just like me, even though Koreans having freckles is highly unusual. I always thought mine were the result of spending too much time lying in the Jersey Shore sun, working on my snooky tan. Could my freckles be genetic? In a recent Halloween photo of Anaïs, she was dressed as an amazing black bird with crazy wings, which, according to a comment, she had made herself. I loved Halloween too, and like Anaïs, I usually chose the funny animal costumes, despite the tendency for women to dress one degree sluttier for trick-or-treating. When I was finished with my cyberstalking, I took a screenshot of Anaïs's Facebook page and texted it to Justin Chan, the star of 21 and Over, for his opinion.
"Dude, that's your twin," he wrote back.
Even though that same thought had slightly grazed my mind, it hadn't truly occurred to me. I like to protect myself, so even if I believed it was probably true, I didn't admit it. Instead, I kept my composure and continued to investigate. And by investigate, I mean that I sent the screenshot to all the people I knew so that I could get their opinions on it. What can I say? I like teamwork. The opinion I valued most was that of my friend Kanoa. He was one of my best friends in Los Angeles, even though I'd only known him a few months. Justin had introduced us and we became close really fast, sharing our funny stories about acting school and commiserating about having to support ourselves as waiters. He was also an ethnic actor. He was Hapa, an ethnically ambiguous blend of Chinese, Caucasian, Hawaiian, and a bunch of other races. Whatever they are, he is gorgeous. Kanoa's opinion was really gentle and comforting. He didn't want to say if he thought I had a twin, but he anticipated that I was likely in shock from being contacted by this French lookalike, so he asked me if I was okay. I really appreciated his sensitivity, especially after Justin's surprisingly bold yet likely true pronouncement. I wanted other opinions too, especially those of my two older brothers, Matt and Andrew. I told them not to tell Mom and Dad, thinking that would make the situation too big, but I wanted them to check out the pictures and tell me what they thought. Typical of my brothers, they didn't give me much. Their responses were, "Wow, weird." They were always so predictably generic. The thread of texts with my friends that ensued was insane. Justin was particularly relentless in his insistence that Anaïs and I were twins.
"Sam, that's your twin. She has to be. It's your twin. She's your twin. Twin, 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 twin."
Finding a long-lost twin only happens in the movies. Like in The Parent Trap. It didn't happen in real life. Just that past summer, I had been to Korea on a roots tour with my mother, and I had had the opportunity to see my birth records at the adoption agency that handled my case in Seoul. There had been no mention of a twin. According to the official record, I had been born alone, a singleton. The document said that my mother had given birth to a daughter 2 years earlier, so that might mean I had an older sister, if I believed that. That information had been added to the record at a later date, so it was even more suspect than the other information. Who knew what, if anything, was true? A few weeks earlier, I had been out with a friend named Robin. She had gone to Korea to find her birth mother. They had a reunion, and when they did a DNA test, it turned out they weren't a biological match. The birth search had been wrong, based on incorrect information. So Robin and the woman had briefly thought that they had found each other, only to be wrong. In Korea, very few birth mothers are brave enough to actually come forward, so Robin had been feeling lucky. I couldn't even fathom her sadness when they discovered the truth. From my search, I knew I had a birth mother who had no interest in me making contact with her, so I let it go for now, although I still hoped that day would come. Now, me having a twin? That was completely inconceivable. Yet, I couldn't get rid of the thought. I mean, she could be my twin. She shared my birthday, and we looked exactly alike. Stranger things have happened. But what if she wasn't a twin or even a relative? My head was spinning. I had to write back to Anaïs, but how do I respond to a message like the one she had sent me? What to say? Hey, LOL, this is crazy! Smiley face, TTYL! I just didn't have a response.
3. Anaïs. Waiting for first contact. The role of social networking in the world today cannot be appreciated enough. By the networks and their available applications, we communicate our ideas, stay informed, market our merchandise, share our photos, present our opinions, and absorb enormous amounts of knowledge. Some so trifling we are confused as to why we ever needed it. We stay connected with friends, and we find friends we have lost touch with by way of a few keyword searches. Without social networking, I would never have found Samantha Futterman. There is an upside and a downside to the connectedness on the internet. As great as it is to communicate with people all over the world, we get overly accustomed to instant gratification. We become used to the immediacy of it all. Write a blog and get instant feedback. Post a tweet and watch it get retweeted again and again. Post something on Facebook and see how many friends like it in a matter of minutes. After I sent my message to Samantha saying we might be twins, the most important message I had ever sent in my life, I expected an instant response. Instead, I found myself waiting, and waiting, and waiting. In anxious anticipation of Samantha's reply, I knew I wanted the moral support of my friends. Kelsang offered to have a waiting for contact pizza party at his flat, and I gladly accepted his invitation. Kelsang and his flatmates, and our friends Rafa, Angel, and Marta, were the ideal distractions. Takeaway pizzas from Pizza Hut sounded good to me. Everybody in the room was almost as excited as I was. We all kept refreshing our Twitters and Facebooks, making sure we didn't miss anything that might come in, even for a minute. To keep the waiting fun, we drank lots of wine, ate our pizza, and spent the time laughing and joking. But the levity didn't calm me down. I was a bundle of nerves. The more time that passed without any response from Samantha, the more my doubts and insecurities started to surface. Everybody else was still hyped up, but my focus was on what could be going wrong. I had already factored in the time zone differences, and as it was 7 o'clock in the evening here in London, it was about 11 in the morning for Samantha in California. If she was anything like me, and I assume she was, she would have gotten up fairly recently, and she would be checking all of her social media. So, why wasn't she writing back? I was suddenly alarmed that she wouldn't see my message. Or worse, she would, but wouldn't answer. On Facebook, you could see if somebody had read your message. So I was watching my computer screen, waiting for the pernicious, seen at blah blah time, but it never appeared.
I waited at Kelsang's until well after midnight, but no reply from Samantha. By now, it would be late afternoon in California, so it would be almost impossible for her not to have logged on. It crossed my mind that she could have a Facebook privacy setting that would allow her to see my Facebook request without my knowing. If that was the case, and she wasn't responding, there was nothing I could do about it. There was also the possibility that it had gone to her spam box, so my request would be equally doomed. I was exhausted, emotionally and physically. Waiting was only adding to my anxiety, and although I knew what I was waiting for, Samantha lived in another world. Having expectations about what she would do with my friend request was getting me nowhere. All I could do was go home and get into bed. I still couldn't stop obsessing about her. I watched Samantha's videos 1,000 times before falling asleep. Where was she? What was she doing at this moment? Those were my first thoughts when I woke up on Wednesday, February 20th, 2013. My probable twin was out there somewhere, over there in America, and I was feeling energized. When I talked to my parents, I promised to send them some of the amazing pictures of Samantha I had found on Instagram. Mom seemed to be getting really excited about the idea of what she could discover from the photos. Dad was not as enthusiastic, although he encouraged me to send on what I had found. Obviously, if I had a long-lost twin, this was going to impact more than just me. The dynamics of our entire family would change. Theoretically, my parents would suddenly have another daughter. Wait a minute. That would mean I had 2 sets of parents. Would I have to explain to 4 people that I wanted a tattoo? Who would Samantha's parents be to me? Who would everybody be to one another? I adored the set of parents I had. Would I have to share them with Samantha now? I generally don't give away my feelings for others, but my parents are incredible people, and I cannot imagine life without them. They are my real parents, the ones I argue with and admire at the same time. They are loving, thoughtful, and kind. What if I didn't like Samantha's parents? What if Samantha didn't like my parents? What would our parents be to one another? Would everybody get along? What would we do about holidays and birthdays? Spend them all together? Or alternate houses, like married couples do with in-laws? I was probably getting ahead of myself, but slowly, the idea of having a twin started to really weigh on me. I lay in my bed paralyzed, contemplating all the possible relationships and scenarios. And as of yet, the Futtermans were only strangers. They didn't even know about the Bordiers. Bringing myself back to the present, I looked at Sam's Twitter again, hoping to find something I may have missed the day before. I called Mum to let her know I was still doing okay, and she suggested I send Samantha a message, asking if she had been born in Busan, like me. Samantha had not yet answered my Facebook request, so my biggest fear remained that she might never answer me, no matter how many messages I sent her. I was glad I had revisited Samantha's Twitter. This time, I looked at older tweets she had been posting during her trip to Korea the previous year. She had written that her biological mom was from Busan. There was one more clue that we were twins. I called Mom back to tell her, followed by Dad, followed by everyone else I know. There was still the problem of Samantha not having seen my message, so I spent a little longer trying to find out what she had been doing over the past 25 years. Social media like Facebook and WhatsApp have made it so amazingly easy to spy on people through the cables and plugs that interconnect us all. Technology brings voyeurism to a whole new level, and I was so happy to have this tool at my disposal. In her photos, I could see that she liked to wear amazing costumes, and her boyfriend was really, really tall. She seemed to be a very happy, fun, and playful person, except in one photo, when she was about 7 or 8, where she seemed a little lost. She was with her 2 older brothers, and she was holding a baby in her arms. But she wasn't looking directly at the camera and smiling, like her brothers. I don't know why that picture struck me, but it did. I was really indulging myself in Samantha's childhood when my fears returned.
She was never going to accept my friend request, because now I was convinced it had gone to her spam mailbox. I didn't want to send her a message in any public forum, because Samantha was an actress, and therefore vulnerable to stalkers. People like me. I didn't want to post just anywhere for the whole world to see. Already, my friends and I had added her everywhere we could. Instagram, Twitter, WhatsApp, etc. We even became followers of her YouTube channel. It was 2 p.m. by the time I could finally get myself out of bed. I didn't go to school. I was exhausted and hugely disappointed that I hadn't heard back from Samantha. I felt really bad about skipping. Waiting to hear from your potential twin did not make the list of excusable absences, but I didn't care anymore. I only wanted to discover more things about Samantha and who she was. I would have flown to Los Angeles to locate her, doing the best I could with the hints I was picking up from her Instagram. I felt like I was a detective, slowly putting pieces of her story together. Kelsang could sense my trauma and despair. He was sweet enough to invite me to a movie, even though he had a lot of work to do. We went to see Beautiful Creatures, perfectly cheesy for the occasion. After the movie, I checked my phone to see if there was anything new. Samantha still hadn't answered. So, dragging Kelsang with me, I went to French Connection UK to buy my mom a silk top for her birthday. Then we went back to my flat for burgers. In the hour and a half of shopping, and the trip back to my place, there was still nothing. The long, emotional day had left me with more questions, no answers. The things running through my head were wild. What if she is not interested? What if she doesn't want to know about me? What if she thinks I'm a crazy teenage fan obsessed with her? What if she never discovers the message? I was going insane. Kelsang and I talked about if we should tweet her, but again we decided against it. After Kelsang left, I got back into bed, ignoring my exhaustion in favor of watching the videos of my twin again. I fell asleep with the image of Samantha fading into my dreams. By morning, I was feeling downright schizophrenic. I'd watched the videos so many times. I couldn't even tell the difference between Samantha and me anymore. Everything was merging and mixing. The videos seemed real and time was distorted. It was crazy. I had learned so much about Samantha's life in the past few days that she was no longer just an image to me, but a real, breathing person who was walking somewhere on Earth at this very moment. She was moving about, making decisions about what to have for dinner, maybe reading lines for a part, but she was right there with me. The trouble was, I was the only one who knew it. It was like reading a book and slowly unraveling a character, bringing him to life in your imagination. However, I could see photographs of her, and she was made of flesh and bones. When Kelsang came over for breakfast the following morning, we got right on my computer, only to see that Samantha was tweeting. Knowing she was online, Kelsang used the opportunity to post a personal tweet with a mention of her and her handle, which would automatically go to her Mentions tab. My heart was pounding as he tweeted instructions for her to go to her spam box on Facebook, where she would find my message. I panicked as soon as he did it. Worried that it could look too spam-like, I asked him to remove it immediately, which he did. I came up with another idea, to send her a message on her YouTube channel. Kelsang shut me down when he told me he had already tried this tactic, but I did it anyway. Next, I composed a message to her that I was determined to deliver somehow. Oh, good morning. I am your twin sister. Cheers. Never mind. It was a little too bold, and there was no way I could think of to get it to her and be taken seriously. It was time for me to go back to classes. I was right in the middle of the final collection, and missing the previous school day was catastrophic enough. Technically, this was the year you rarely slept, ate, or had any fun, except for discovering a novel sewing technique that could save you 3 hours of work, or, should I say, gain you 3 hours of much-needed sleep. Even if all my focus was on Samantha, I had obligations in London, and I had to get back to work. Only 3 days had passed since I had sent my Facebook friend request, but it felt like 25 years. Nothing else mattered but hearing from Samantha. I wanted to know that she had received my message, but even more, I wanted for her to answer it. I was feeling so vulnerable that I wanted to be home in Paris, being comforted by my mom and dad. They would have supported me in a way that only parents could. Right now, I was feeling overwhelmed with frustration and uncertainty. It was like I was imprisoned somewhere, trying to yell at someone who couldn't hear me, and had never heard of me, and wouldn't know if I were dead or not. It was almost unbearable, knowing about Samantha and knowing that she had absolutely no clue of my existence. I just wanted her to see me, to see my message, and to react. Whatever the reaction was, I just wanted her to know I existed. All I could do was wait. My friends were waiting too, feeling my stress. Everybody wanted a resolution, and some took matters into their own hands. Without me knowing it, my friend Maxence tweeted Samantha from Paris, telling her to look for a message from Anaïs on her Facebook, and then open it and read it. Lucas posted an Instagram photo of me with a handwritten note on the bottom. "Check your spam box." He thought something handwritten would look friendlier than a computerized message, and he was thinking Samantha might not even know there was such a thing as a Facebook spam box. And then it happened. In a life-changing instant, two notifications from Facebook popped up on my phone that Samantha had accepted my friend request and read my message. I was at school in the studio with my friends when I found out. "Yay! Yay! Yay! Yay!" I shouted, crazily jumping around the studio. "She read it! She read it! She read it!" Everyone erupted in cheers. I didn't know it yet, but the winning communication had been Maxence's tweet from Paris. That was the one that had gotten.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.